to everybody for having joined this this really important conference. What I'm going to talk about is the SDG and the social issues. So as the presentation gets going, the important thing I wanted to discuss was, you know, to what has been the impact of the economic downturn on social goals. So, a very simple point, right? I assume that that I am being heard clearly. So, let me just straight away into.
Yes, sir. You're audible, sir. Very clear.
Thank you so much. Thank you. So, what I'm saying is that to all of you, I'm making the first point I'm making is that the Indian economy, in terms of its social objectives, has, because of this problem of the pandemic, the biggest impact has been on the issues. As far as we are concerned, in the SDG conversation, the three issues that I think we should all bear in mind when we are discussing the impact of COVID on the SDG and on the model, on the current economic situation, there are three points that I want to place. The first impact of what has happened in the last 3 months has been on poverty. That is the first impact that we will discuss. The second impact that is equally important has been on hunger. And the third impact that is there an audio problem?
No, sir.
No? All right. Somebody just wrote saying poor audio. So if you can hear me, I'll just proceed. Krishna Prasad.
There is a slight break in your voice. I mean, the sound,
okay.
A very light disruption.
Right. So I'll just repeat what I said. I was saying that the three issues that we need to focus on as far as the SDG discussion is concerned are A, on poverty, B, on hunger, and C, on unemployment. As my discussion is going to be on three issues of poverty, of hunger, and of unemployment. You have by now been through the important issues. These three are very critical goals. I will not go into the SDG goals right now. Let me that about the three issues of hunger. First point is that of poverty. The poverty issue is important because what we have seen is that we have seen the impact on the poor. What do we mean by that? What we mean by that is that over the last two decades, we have seen the largest number of people emerging. We have seen the largest number of people emerging out of poverty. My voice is breaking, and that we are not. Is that correct? Path and Sahitya. Okay.
सर एक्चुअल आपका बैंडविड्थ का प्रॉब्लम है सर सर आप वीडियो ऑफ कर लीजिए सर हेलो सर, हेलो सर, हेलो सर, सर अनम्यूट कर लीजिए सर। सर आपका अनम्यूट कर लीजिए सर। हेलो सर, सर अमीरुल्ला सर, सर आपका वीडियो ऑफ कर लीजिए सर, खाली ऑडियो पे आप सेशन कंप्लीट करिए सर।
Retired post officer and working as chief consultant in the MCRHR Institute. I am going to deal with the topic on environmental sustainability. Yeah, good afternoon. As you, the subject of SDG goals has been dealt in detail by Shri A.K. Jain. There are 17 SDGs, out of which apparently only 4 connected to the environment. Next slide. These are the goal numbers 6, 13, 14 and 15. But if you go into depth, almost all the SDGs are connected with the environment, and particularly 3, 6, 7, 9, 12, 13, 14 and 15. That's 9 out of 17 sustainable development goals are having some linkage or the other with the environment. And in this connection, all the institutions which are involved in higher education, they can play very, very important role in bringing an awareness about these goals to their students and also public in general. Next. So these are the 9 SDGs which are having linkages with the environment. Next. Now, in talking about the environmental sustainability, our understanding in general is that meeting the resource and services needs of the current and future generations. The emphasis is also not only on the current generation but future generation, without compromising the health of the ecosystems that provide these services. So this is the broad understanding of the environmental sustainability. This has been worked upon by a team led by Dr. John Morelli of the Rochester Institute of Technology. He and his team, they have proposed this elaborate definition of the environmental sustainability. It says that a condition of balance, resilience, and interconnectedness that allows human society to satisfy its needs while neither exceeding the capacity of its supporting ecosystem to continue to regenerate the services necessary to meet those needs, nor by our actions diminishing biological diversity. So the needs of the human society, the present as well as the future generation, shall be met in such a manner that we don't cause any damage to the ecosystems. And the major component of the ecosystem is the biological diversity. Next. The importance of biodiversity can be gauged by this fact that the World Environment Day 2020, which we celebrated merely 5 days ago, the focus is on the biodiversity. Next. The theme of the current year's World Environment Day was celebrate biodiversity. I say it's not only celebration, but also conserve biodiversity. Conservation is much more important in these days. Unless biodiversity is conserved, preserved, protected, nurtured by the human beings, there will be no biodiversity left for celebration. So celebration is only with conservation. Next. To understand the importance of environment and biodiversity, let us look at the bigger picture, the ecosystem. What is the ecosystem? Eugene P. Odom has given a wonderful definition of the ecosystems, that any unit that includes all the organisms, that is the community or biotic component of the ecosystem, in a given area interacting with the physical environment so that a flow of energy leads to a clearly defined trophic structure, biotic diversity, and material cycles. That's exchange of materials between living and non-living parts. Within the system is an ecological system or ecosystem. So two things need to be understood here, that unless there is flow of energy and cycling of nutrients, any system devoid of any of these two factors cannot be termed as an ecosystem. So ecosystems could be a forest ecosystem, it could be crop ecosystem, it could be freshwater ecosystem, it could be marine water ecosystem, and so on and so forth. All the ecosystems will be consisting of the 6 ingredients, that is inorganic substances, organic compounds like proteins, fats, everything, climate regime, temperatures, rainfall, then the producers of the organic, the either plants and animals, whether they are microorganisms or macro plants and animals, which produce the food, which photosynthesize and provide food to everybody else. Then macro consumers, which includes human beings also, the tigers, panthers, elephants, or whales, all this, they fall in the category of the macro consumers. They consume on the, they survive on the producers. And micro consumers, the bacteria and fungi, which may be available in the air or water or soil, and they basically decompose the organic matter to facilitate recycling of the nutrients. Next. So this is a picture which depicts a typical ecosystem where you find that from the sun, solar energy, the leaves of the plants, whether they are trees or bushes or herbs or animals, they synthesize the food by consuming carbon dioxide and they release oxygen. And when these plants die, they are decomposed with the help of bacteria and fungi, and the nutrients go back into the soil. They also help in the recharge of the groundwater. They support large number of plants and animals, so zooplankton, phytoplankton, bacteria, fungi, insects, larvae, and bigger and small animals. So all this put together composes an ecosystem. Next. This is the same, another depiction of the ecosystem. Go to next. The ecosystems, they safeguard lives and livelihoods in many ways. Coastal defense, the surveys, flood regulation, water, purification, fisheries, livelihood provision, water conveyance and navigation, cultural services, carbon sequestration, coastal defense, water provision and water service, and many more services. We'll discuss about these things later on. But unless there is a sound ecosystem which is nurtured, preserved, all these services will not be available. Next. Now we'll discuss about some of the problems which we are facing, which compose or comprises the climate change. We often hear about the global warming. We often hear about the greenhouse gases. What do they do? Why are we so much concerned about the climate change, global warming, emission of the greenhouse gases? Next. We have got a protective layer around the earth, roughly 30 to 50 kilometers above the earth's surface, and it is comprising of the ozone gas. The oxygen and ozone, they keep on changing. But this is a protective shield against the ultraviolet rays, which are coming from the sun. So it is not allowed to reach the earth's surface. And thereby, the earth's temperature is maintained. For last many, many centuries or millions of years, the earth's temperature has not gone up beyond 1.5 degrees centigrade. But now the scientists say that it may go to 2 degrees. So even if there is a rise of half a degree temperature on the earth's surface, what is going to happen? We will be feeling extremely hot weather. 14% of the global population will be exposed to severe heat at least once every year. And if the temperature goes to 2 degrees, it will be 37%. That means 2.6 times situation will be worsening. Like sea ice free Arctic, at least every 100 years the temperature is 1.5 degrees. If it goes to 2 degrees, it will happen in 10 years, once in 10 years. So that means 10 times situation is going to be worse. Sea levels will rise. In last so many years, the temperature at 1.5 degrees, there was a rise of only 40 centimeters. But it will go up to 46 centimeters. And with this rise, many of the coastal cities will be flooded. They will be submerged. So that's the problem. I hope that most of you must have seen the film of Al Gore, The Inconvenient Truth. So these details you can find. How many cities, which city, in which country is going to be submerged. Next. Coral reefs, there will be reduction, decline in the coral reef. Coral reef are the food for the fish and all the marine life. If their quantity declines, so there will be not much food left for the marine life. And you know, majority of the people in the world are dependent on the marine products. So if temperature goes by half a degree more, 99% of the coral reef will be declined. So that's 29% worsening situation. Fisheries, in marine fisheries, 1.5 million tons will go up to, decline will be up to 3 million tons. That is, it will be, rate of decline will be doubling. So this is the impact of increase in the temperature. Next. This we can also extrapolate, say there are studies, there are many more factors. There will be melting of the snow caps. This will lead to many other problems, flooding in the plains, all types of things will happen. Another problem which we feel on the environmental front is the bioaccumulation. Bioaccumulation, that means we are polluting the, say suppose, the oceans. We release a lot of, say, pollutants. Pollutants per se, like DDT, it may look minuscule to us, but when small planktons consume it, then it goes small particles, small quantity into their cells. And when they are consumed by the small fishes are eaten by the bigger fishes by otters, and say polar bear likes, with every stage, with the passage of energy, there is more and more accumulation of these are pollutants, which will lead to dear that. And that's how many of these species are becoming extinct, only because of the actions, wrong actions of the human beings. Next. Another example you can see of DDT only, say, when it say fishes are eaten by birds, already the quantity of, so you can see per parts per million, it is going up from 5,000 to 25 to 5,000 in the case of birds, and that leads to that. Next. So it's a bioaccumulation and biomagnification. With every stage in the food web, when we start from the microorganisms and go to the bigger animals, there is more accumulation of the pollutants leading to their death. Next. Next. Another example we can take of diclofenac. It's a medicine used for the, say, pain, giving relief from pain to the human beings. But much larger, though it has been banned in 2006, many of the places, the veterinary doctors, they were administering these medicine to the cattle. When the cattle died, it was found that there was huge amount of this particular medicine in their carcasses. When these carcasses were eaten by the eagle, they died, vultures. The vultures died. And only when we started finding, especially in India and globally also, why there is a huge decline in the population of the vultures, then it was traced to the diclofenac. And then it was banned. And now efforts are being made to revive the population of the vultures. Special efforts are being made because we cannot afford to lose any species. Because all species play very, very important role in the maintenance of ecological balance. And that particular function is known as ecological niche. Ecological niche of each and every species is distinct, unique. Nobody, no species can take over the role of